Well, greetings, everyone. I hope you're having a good Monday. It's good to be with you all after the weekend, and it's good to kind of get things started with the week. A lot of times people have asked me, and I get both the encouragement and also the question about where do I get the people that I talk about. A lot of times they're in a calendar in our respective church's hymnal. And I have grown by learning about all these different people. It isn't that I can relate to everyone. Everyone is very different in the body of Christ, including each of these people. Now, the one we're going to talk about today is a guy by the name of Nathan Soderblom. And I had read about him many times at seminary. He was a Swedish Lutheran bishop. But what interested me so much in Nathan is that he was a pioneer in what is called the ecumenical movement, and also into the dialogue with other religions. The reason that interested me so much is because one of the things that Nathan Soderblom discovered as an academic student is his interest in what is at the heart of people's need for God. And it's usually expressed in the religions of the world. And that one could find, if Jesus Christ is the Word of God, the needs that Jesus can fulfill in the lives of other people as a precursor not only for evangelism, but for getting to know people that are different from us. And so one of the things that he desired was both peace within the church, meaning how one and all the other denominations within Christianity can relate to one another, and peace without of the church. How can people of differing backgrounds come together for the cause of peace and issues in the world? Now, in some cases, this can lead to compromise. And that was something that Nathan and others tried to avoid. Our convictions of what we believe about Jesus Christ, the convictions that even where two or three are gathered in his name, should lead us not away from other people, but toward other people, to find some common ground. And yet, sometimes that can get a little out of hand. Sometimes we can relate too much to people that we kind of lose our mission, lose ourselves. But if we have the true conviction that God who says he is in Jesus Christ, God who is the person who died on the cross for our sins, the one who loves the world, for that's what we teach, don't we? That God so loved the world that he gave us his only son. It will cause us to be more deeply into the mission of God. I always like to have a quote from the people we're talking about. Here's one from Nathan. He quotes from Kierkegaard, the famous theologian, that life is a poem and that we are able to write it ourselves. But a Christian lets God write his life's poem. And that's, I think, important for us to remember today. That while we can be creative and we can be the author and director of many of our life choices, what we are first called to do is to get on our knees and pray and find where God is leading us, where God is guiding us. And even if we have gone along with our own wisdom and strength and free will to go to where we believe God is calling us, to let God interrupt and to guide us either back on course if we have strayed, or to continue the course with perseverance and strength. And that's the inspiration I have from Nathan Soderblom. He was a bishop, which meant that it was a political position. It didn't mean that he was going to get along with everyone. In fact, most of his life, all he could hear were the people on both sides, either liberal-leaning people who thought he was too conservative and too religious, and more conservative people who thought that he had compromised and was making Christianity too political. Nathan tried to find a medium ground, and that didn't always suit people well. I know for myself, as a pastor in a mainline church, I understand that middle ground that some people view as compromise, but others view as the right place that we need to be if we are followers of Jesus Christ. Convictions that come from our understanding that our sins have been forgiven and anchoring ourselves in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Yes, never compromising from that. But yet open to hear what people's needs are and to hear where their journey is with God and to learn how to interact. And that's where I've had and found some inspiration from Nathan Soderblom, to be open to having a conversation with my neighbor, whether they are of a different denomination or even a different religion, to keep on interested in the lives of others. Because Jesus was interested so much in our life that he died on the cross for our sins. And he calls us to take up our cross and follow him. A lot of the work that Nathan did happened after he passed away, untimely, really, in 1931. He was only in his mid-50s. But one of the things that he led to was the creation of what is called the World Council of Churches. Now, there's been a lot of complaints about the World Council of Churches, that it's kind of too academic and that it is compromised in many ways. But it has tried to be the meeting ground of people of other faiths, including Christians, so that they can talk together and learn how to tackle the issues of this world. Yes, we might say that maybe in some ways Christians can lose their perspective in their dialogue, in their work in this world. But what's more important is that we do work in this world with the conviction and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Because equally as deadly is when we decide to flee from this world and just hide in our own closets, in our own protective ways. The Christian is to be both a person of conviction and a person that is open to the world. Thank you, Nathan Soderblom. And thank you for others who are working to build these bridges of faith. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you think of those who long ago came to faith and were people of understanding and people of conviction, yet people open to the needs of others in this world. Lord, thank you for the freedom to write our story, but interrupt it so that it becomes a story within your story, the story of the good news that you died and rose again. Bless us now on our journey of faith. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow.